Like a TV show chef, I actually quickly made this last night just so I make sure that I don't kind of stumble in class. But anyway, so this is what we're gonna do. It's an incredibly simplified Herzog and Cameron, their bird nest in Beijing. But the thing about this, which is kind of cool, is that you can get, and also we'll fix those gaps there, you can get some pretty complex geometry going on that in a few simple steps sort of thing. So I'll show you how to do this. So gonna open another Rhino window. Also, this file is in the Dropbox folder if you want to look at it. So when you're first starting out, what you want to do is maybe organize your layers. So in this case, we know we're going to have reference material. So I'm just going to make a reference layer like that and then set it to default. Now, what we want to do with this is we want to import our pictures that we're referring to. And to do this, there's a really good command called picture frame. I don't know where this command is in the toolbars. It's one of those ones like I usually type commands anyways. Anyways, it's somewhere, but if you just type in picture frame, hit enter, what it's going to do is it's going to bring up a Windows browser or Mac browser, and you're going to navigate to a picture you want. So usually, I think it works with all of these image files. I've had some strange results happening with PNGs and TIFFs. So I usually try to stick with JPEG, maybe bitmap. So I'm going to navigate to our image. So if you want to follow along, these images will be in the Dropbox folder, in class files, and then January 19th. And the first one I'm going to grab is the, I'll start out with the section. So when you're placing a picture frame, it's just like drawing a rectangular surface. So you'll see I'm going to click for the bottom corner. And then now you can see that essentially what's happening is there's this rectangle that, you know, maintains the aspect ratio of the picture you want to place. It comes out. So if you hold shift, you can place it along a grid line. So I'm just going to kind of scale it up. We're not really concerned about scale right now. So I'm just going to place it wherever. So there is our section. And you can see, maybe I'll just put this midpoint to the origin there. So I'm going to go to transform, move. You can snap to these picture frames like you would any other surface. So I can find the midpoint. And then I'm going to move it to, I'm just going to enter 0 to move it to the origin. So you can see in your perspective that now we have this picture frame. So when you're doing this, essentially what you should do is you should have all your reference images open. So in this case, if I go here, look at the ones that I have, you can see that it sort of has almost this saddle type appearance. So here's a few reference materials I have. So this gives us a good idea of where we want to place this. So we know that this section we just placed is cutting through this way. Whereas the section right here, you can see, obviously it's cutting through the center. You can see that opening. So I believe it's cutting this way. And what we're looking back at is where this lip here rises up. So since this is reflected, we'll actually use two of these long sections. So we'll place them in the picture frame next. So let's place, so again, we can just type in picture frame. Oh, picture frame, like so. We're going to place the long section out of here. And for right now, since we'll have to resize this, I'm just going to place it at, you know, more or less the same size. So we're going to grab, I believe that's the right surface. Nope, the other one. So we're going to grab this surface. Since it's this section in the other way, we're going to rotate this like so. And actually, before we rotate this, sorry, we probably want to make sure it's the right height. So we want to make sure these are the same scale, of course. So the way we can do that is I'm just going to place them side by side in our front view. I'm going to say that this is the proper height right here. So maybe I'll set up a few lines. So in this case, I'm going to set up one line here for my ground plane. Turn off grid snap. So I'm just going to drag this across. I'm going to make sure that our ground plane here lines up. So in this case, you can see it lines up just below this little rise here. So I'll place this more or less like this. Again, for this project, things don't need to be exact, but it's good to get things to a certain level of exactitude just so it looks convincing. And then the next, I guess, datum line we want is the top, so the height here. So I'm just going to pull this out in the same way. I'll go like that. Now this, essentially, I just want to scale it. So this line, maybe I'll move this line up a little bit so it's right on that line. So essentially what we want to make sure is we want to make sure that this line right here is on this line here. So the line on the image matches the line there. And then the top point there matches this top line. So you could scale 2D. I'm just going to hold shift and use gumball and then just kind of move it till I'm happy with it. So that maybe is a little bit too big. I'll move this up. And that looks more or less about right. So now these are lined up height-wise, so that's good. So now, essentially what we're going to do is we're just going to place this. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to rotate this since it's the section in the other direction. And then I'm just going to move it over until, so I guess this section here, it's taken right through the middle, we're assuming. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to move this section here until it's the midpoint intersects here, so I can actually move this over. So I'm going to grab this guy here. I'm going to look into my right plane. I am going to turn on project and planar just so it doesn't move forward and backwards in the right view here. Transform move. So I'm going to move it over. I'm going to make sure smart track's on. I'm going to snap right there and then go that intersection point. So now this is centered. Actually, it looks like maybe it isn't quite centered because the image is off center a little bit. So we'll say that is more or less centered like that. So that looks about right. So now you can see what we have here is our two sections right here. And they match up fairly well at this point. That's what we want. So does anyone have any questions about what's going on here? So yeah, so more or less it's just like you would in our last assignment, you've made the 2D drawings, generated 3D from it. Here we're just using the pre-existing 2D drawings to help us guide our 3D modeling. Since this guy's mirrored, we know the same section more or less exists on this side. I'm just going to mirror it. So mirror, go to our mid, make sure copy's on there, and go like that. Yeah, you can just stretch it with gumball. Again, this process is not, like, obviously these are, you know, pixelated images. You wouldn't take measurements off these. So it's more or less just for your own reference so you can make a convincing 3D model. And you'll see, like, from the the last one I made here, obviously this is not this. And if you were to do this for this in this class, it would be okay because you're demonstrating 3D modeling and we'd get the gist of it. So the final thing we want to place here is the plan, of course. So I'm going to go picture frame again. Here's a plan I found. And this one we're going to place on the bottom. So going to my top view here, placing like so. And essentially what I'm going to do is I'm going to draw out some lines because it's kind of hard to see how we'd line this up. So I think I'm just going to draw out some lines here. So from our front view, we can set, maybe we can make a new layer here called guidelines. We'll make it a bright color so it's visible. So this neon pink. Oh, guys, if you work in Dropbox, make sure not to cut out or delete things. Just copy to your desktop. So with this, we're just going to draw from this point here, so the widest point. Actually, let's look at this plan because maybe it's taken from below. So with this, again, we're just making some assumptions, like where is this plan taken? What do you guys think? Is this a roof plan or just a plan? It's your call. Like, there's no right answer. I'm not sure. It's post-shade anyways, I think. Okay, so what I'm going to do then is I'm just going to make this guide, and then I'm going to consider it maybe a roof plan, I guess. So for this, we can't smart track to an image, so I'm just going to go like this. So I'm, I don't know, making these messy lines, and I'm just going to redraw it. Okay, and then I'll delete the messy one. So here's our guide in the in this direction. So we can see now in our top view, we have this here, and we know that this being, so let's again refer our image. With something like this, you want to continually look back to your images to make sure you're doing it properly. Class files, January 19th. Okay, so in this case, we know that the little flip-ups happen on the short side. So this flip-up should go like that, because that there are the flips, and this is the short side there. So I'm just going to move this until it matches up. So you can see I'm not really taking a lot of, I'm not being super exact with this, but that's okay. So that looks more or less all right. So, perfect. Now we have all our reference images lined up. Maybe we don't even, we'll leave that guideline. We might need some more. But anyways, that's good. Now, one thing we want to do, since this would be really difficult to work with because everything's opaque, you can see if we're going to do drawings in this view, this image here is pretty high contrast, is the center of attention, so it gets to be kind of distracting. Perhaps what we want to do then is reduce the opacity of these picture planes so that they're easier to work with. So in this case, what we can do is we can click on any given picture plane, go to properties, and then material, and then under basic settings, you can see at the lowest slider here in the basic settings, there's the transparency slider. So we can increase that to get just a ghosted image of that. So We're going to do that for all these picture frames. We can select them all at once and do so. So again, you'll see that our preview doesn't show up because there's multiple textures for the different picture planes. But if we increase the transparency, they will all decrease. So whatever looks good, I guess this is about 88% transparent. And I think this will be good for our purposes, like so. So that's great. Does anyone have any questions with that? Want me to go over that again? Yeah? Okay, so transparency, to change the transparency of the of any object, really. So you just select it, and then you make sure you go to your Properties tab, little rainbow wheel, click on, so it'll look like this by default, click on the little paint tube, the Material tab there, and then under the Basic Settings, it might be closed like that if yours looks like this. You want to open Basic Settings, and then the Transparency, which is the lowest slider there, just increase that up to maybe like 88% or, you know, 90, less, more, whatever. So that is how you do the transparencies. Now, one thing we also want to do, so if we're drawing lines around all these things, and like, let's say we're drawing, you know, this line here. So there's our outline. And then we want to move it, or we want to quickly select this and move it, but now our background's moved. So another thing to keep in mind is that you probably want to lock your reference layers, whether or not they're on. So our reference layers are right here. I'm going to lock them. So you just click that little locked padlock icon, and then now you can't select them. So we can go across all of them, and like that. You could also turn off your surfaces under your object selection filter. I'll show you how to access this again if you don't have it up. Just if you want to get that selection filter on your screen, click on this filter at the bottom there. You'll have this little menu pop up. This is really, really handy. Essentially, whatever isn't clicked here, you can't select. So in this case, curves isn't clicked, so I can't select it. If I turn off the lock so I can select these surfaces, let's say I just want to select curves, I could turn on curves, turn off surfaces, and now I can only select curves. So selection filter is super useful to use, so you can just place it up here. So it's always up there when you open Rhino. But in this case, I'm actually just going to use lock instead. So we have our guide curves there. So we're going to be using some familiar commands and some new commands. The first command we're going to use is drawing line commands. So we'll do those first. So the first thing we want to do is maybe draw this section right here. So there's probably a bunch of different ways to do this. I'm going to do it in a way that shows us like new novel commands, like curve network or surface network. So in this case, we could just draw this section here and try to do some rotate around the center or whatnot. But then we probably wouldn't get the full double curvature of this upper surface. And this is where surfaces get kind of complex, is when you're trying to model double surfaces. So like a saddle shape that curves both this way and this way. So for that, you probably want to break it down into smaller parts. So in this case, I am just going to draw the full outline. So what I'm going to do is I am going to start with drawing some lines. So I'm actually going to start by like almost sketching this out. So I am going to, and actually we can turn off the guidelines now. I'm going to make a new layer, again called, we'll call these section curves. And we'll make this a different color, blue. So I'm going to start by kind of sketching this out. Before we were using our control point curves and then just going crazy with it, I'll show you how I'd sort of move to make a more refined curve in this case, because there's some straight sections and really subtle curves elsewhere. So I'm going to probably start with just my polyline tool. I'm going to find whichever point that's right below the outline. I'm going to pull it up, and I'm actually going to extend it past. So you can see right there, it is more or less straight. So that looks good to me, and I'll just click like that. The other thing we are going to do, so now we can try a few kinds of curves here. I'll just start with the control point curve, so our standard, see if that serves us well. You want to kind of pick a point that's in line with this curve. So imagine it keeps going. So maybe about like right there. Click onto the curve. You want as few points as possible. And you want to make sure that the last two points are at the same level. And why I'm saying that is that we are going to mirror this. And here, I'll just demonstrate why I did that. So we'll refine this curve some more. So the reason why you want these last two points in this curve, curves, you can press F10, but that stops the video. So in this case, I'll go edit, control points on F10. So you can see these last two control points are at the same level. The reason why we want to do that is, let's say we just tried to make a curve like this that, you know, had a bowl, and our curves were, you know, on different levels. But then we mirrored this, so we go transform mirror. And now all of a sudden you see we have this little angle in the center, which is not very nice for this kind of geometry. So if you have the last two points at the same level, so in this case I'm holding shift to drag it out from the last point, hit enter, go transform mirror. And now you can see it's a perfect transition. So that's just something to keep in mind when you're drawing curves. If you need to have a symmetrical curve like that, you want the last two points to be at the same level before your center point. So we have our curve here, not F10. I'm going to go to edit, control points on. And this, so we can move this point here. We can't move it up or down, but we can move it to the left or right. So I'm moving it, and you see the curve moves with the point, so I'm just trying to get it line up more or less with this, but also to have a nice curve. So this one maybe will move a little bit more like that. That one looks fine. And so this, I'm actually going to change the color of this layer because it's kind of hard to see. So this, you know, for all intents and purposes, looks pretty good. So the way I'd make this corner here is I wouldn't try to draw this curve. You could use the, let's say, the arc tool. So in here, actually not the arc tool, in the circle commands, there's this, where is it? Right here. Circle, tangent, radius, where you can choose two curves, and after that choose, actually that works pretty good, I'm going to use that. So I'll show you a few different ways of doing this. So what I was originally going to do is I was just going to extend the curves, so by line. I was going to trim these two curves. Trim, and then I was going to fillet the curves like so. But maybe a more accurate way of doing this, so I'll go back to where I was, is underneath your circle tools. If you hold down left mouse button, it brings up our extended menu. If you go to circle, tangent, radius, Click on the first curve you want the circle to be tangent to. Click on the second curve you want the circle to be tangent to. And then, so the radius, what you can do is you can click somewhere between those two curves and pull back and forth, and you can see how it makes a larger circle, but it's always tangent to these two curves. You can drag it until it looks at about the right point, click, and we have this circle here. So now what we can do is we can select these three curves. I'm going to use the trim tool, so trim right there. You can type TR, and I'll trim away that, and I'll trim away those extra lines like that. It looks like we have an extra little thing out there, which is fine. So I'm going to hit join to join all these curves. So you can see four curves joined into two open curves. We just have this little remnant there. So that's the second open curve. I deselect this curve by hitting control and clicking on it, and then hit delete to get rid of that. So we have this outline here. Now I'm just going to mirror it. So I'm going to go to transform, mirror. Copy, yes. And as you can see, we apparently weren't on the exact center point in the drawing. But c'est la vie. That's good enough for this. So when you're doing your own, of course, you're not going to give yourself, I hope, a 2-hour timeline. So you would go back and adjust this image so it is actually on center. But for our purposes, that's more or less okay. Now, what we're going to do, so we have our center curve there. The next curves we want to do, we can actually line these up better as well, is we want to more or less find the point at which, so this top part there intersects with this curve here. So it looks like essentially what we have here is a little bit too far to the left. So you guys, I probably didn't say that properly or explain it right. So I'm going to unlock this layer. I'm going to increase the opacity on these guys, so decrease the transparency. So essentially what we want to do is we want this point right here, which if we look is the top of this dome, to match up with our curve right here at a certain point. I'm actually going to delete this one because we'll mirror it again. So to do that, we'll just push this over until we're right there. So you see now how these two points meet up. So we'll actually just mirror the curve we draw afterwards. But now we know that from this, we can draw this curve across like that. So let's work on drawing that. We are going to go to our right view. We're going to actually, again, decrease the increase the transparency of this. We're going to go to layers, lock our reference layer again. We are going to, again, just more or less use the same technique. So I'm going to draw a line here that more or less matches. If you kind of miss it like I did, you see how it's sort of going in too much, you can use control points for single lines too. So in this case, edit, control points on, select this and just kind of wiggle it till it is in the right place. So now we want to draw this curve here. We're going to go to control point curves, just go somewhere out there. Again, we want two points, like so. And then we're going to do the same thing. We're going to turn control points on for this curve and adjust it so it fits the curve properly. So edit, control points on. It looks like this middle one's the main one we'll be moving. This one can also move up a bit. Maybe pulled out a little bit. And that more or less looks pretty good. We're going to use our same circle tangent to these two curves. So we're going to go circle, tangent, tangent, radius. Click to that curve, click to that curve. And then our radius that we have from the last one is actually the same. That's good. It means we've more or less scaled the drawings correctly. So in this case, we don't have to drag it back and forth. We can just hit enter. If you do know the radius of your corner, your rounded corner, you can just enter it in this command line here. So I'm going to hit enter. And there is our rounded corner. I'm going to select all these curves again, type in trim, or hit trim there, and just trim away all the parts I don't need. So hit enter, and then hit join. So three curves joined into one open curve. And then finally, we are going to mirror all of our curves. Like that. So why don't we even just turn off these two reference, so we're just hiding them, to see what we have here. So we can see we have our curve here. We probably actually want to trim this one down so it matches the bottom of these curves. So in this case, let's go to, I can just draw a line. So turn off project. I'm going to draw a line from here to here. In our front view, I'm going to hit trim. And work. Okay, that's not working, but that's okay. Essentially, if that doesn't work, we can just extend a surface. So extrude curve straight. Direction, if a surface just goes in the wrong way like that, you can just drag out the direction, both sides, yes. And now we can use this surface to trim away those extra curves. So I know I'm moving pretty quickly in all this. I'm going to save these files. So after this next step, I'm going to save it. These, of course, I'm recording this. You can go back and review. But ultimately, I'm just reviewing curve stuff now, showing you quick ways to do it so you can refer back to it rather than taking a lot more time on a lot less material. So if you think like, whoa, today's moving even faster than usual, yeah, it definitely is. So just go back, review the videos, and also not all of this is going to apply to all your modeling you ever do, but there's some really good techniques in here. So what we want to do is essentially we want to find the point where this curve intersects with this curve. So the way we can do that is we can draw a polyline. So I just went to polyline there. We can go to the end point there, so we know that's the top. Hold shift to drag it out. And then just turn on int. And turn off the mid snap, the perp snap, the vertex snap, and the end snap, even smart track, and find the intersection point. So that's right there. And then we're just going to move this over, like so. Since we know it's the same on the other side, we're going to mirror it. So transform mirror. Let's find our end. So there we have the beginnings of our bird's nest. So again, this doesn't look like much right now, but it's actually going to give us a pretty good model of kind of a doubly curved building. So if we look at this here, essentially what we can see is that we need a few other things. So first of all, we need to make this base, the plan. It's kind of oval in form. So we're going to make that oval next, and we're going to make a few ovals around these points. And then after that, I think we should have enough to start making some surfaces. So you really don't need a lot even for these. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to turn off the reference, and I'm going to start by making, I think for this, I will probably go to, so we've done mostly control point curve. Now what we want to do is go interpolate points. And what that does, so again, this is all in the Rhino manual. So our control point curve, our standard curve, you can see how the control points are here and the curve sort of like a vehicle driving through pylons or something, it just avoids the points. If we go to our interpolate points curve here, so the second one, you can see instead what happens is the curve is always on our control points. And the reason why we want to use this one in this case is that we need to make sure that our curve is always on these points here. So if we draw an interpolated curve through these points, you can see what happens is we actually pretty easily get a nice oval shape like that. At this point, if we refer to our reference image, you can see that we're a little bit off. Like if you're working with this, honestly, what I'd do, like let's say you had to refer to it and you had to show a teacher this, I'd probably just go like that. And then like that, and then it's good-ish. More or less what I'm saying here is that in this project, you can't get everything perfectly right. You can, and that'd be appreciated if you really wanted to do that, but more it's just about learning to model. So I doubt that Herzog and Demeron designed and modeled this building in 2 hours anyways. So we have this. We want to do the same thing for the top. So essentially what we're going to do is we're going to make this in two separate parts. We're going to make the roof, and then we're going to make the sides. So we're going to use the same thing. So we're going to go to curve or interpolate points. We're going to go to the bottoms of our rounded corners here. We're going to draw through them like that. And then now you can really start to see it take form. It's like Rhino's good in this way, like with really not a ton of information, we're starting to be able to get some pretty nice things going on. So maybe we can draw some other lines here. So essentially the more lines you have, the more control you're going to have over your surfaces. So for example, we could always draw a line if we choose the quad snap here that connects those points right there to define the surface at that point. So I can draw it in both ends like that. And also what I'm going to do is perhaps connect the top of these doubly curved. Here, let me check just right here what I drew. Oh, I just drew the top here. Okay, well, I guess that worked even better. So I'm gonna draw both in this case. So I'm gonna delete these. So just play around until you get something you like. So in this case, I'm also gonna draw the top right there. And we might not even need all of these curves, but it's good to just sort of get an idea of how you're gonna map out your geometry. So, like so. So now we're really starting to see the shape. If we want to now, we can use the interpolate curve again. interpolate points, to go to quad, quad, quad. And again, you see we're starting to get that nice curve. And quad, quad, quad. The other thing we can do here is, I think that in the last one I drew a center line. Yeah, I did. So we can start making more curves. So again, with interpolate points, we can start drawing from this endpoint here to, let's say, the endpoint there, so the middle point to the endpoint there. And again, we're still getting a nice curve. So when you're doing something like this, all you're really looking for is that it kind of intuitively and visually makes sense. Like if you have some wild curve that's jumping up like that, you know that it's probably, there's something not quite right there. So what we can do now is we can actually start making our base surfaces upon which we'll project our patterns. So in this case, since we know that this thing is essentially symmetrical in two directions, we can kind of choose how we want to set this up. To save some time, we're going to essentially, for the base, split into two halves lengthwise, and then we're just going to mirror it. So if you were modeling this, you'd probably take time to make two separate sides. As we can see here, it doesn't look like the pattern mirrors itself. But for the sake of this class, we'll probably just mirror it. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take this bottom curve, this top curve, and this even more top curve, and I'm just going to split them. So I'm clicking on split with my center curves here. So hit enter. So now you can see we have these three curves. I actually really don't need this middle curve, and you'll see why in a second. So I'm going to get rid of that. And then what we're also going to do is, since we're going to work on the sides and then the top, we're going to take this curve here and this curve here, and we're also going to split these with this curve here. So we're sort of splitting out the side curves and the top curves. So I just hit split there. So in this case, you can see that our side curves are like that. Now, do you guys remember from last class, if you have two curves which can be rails, what command would you use to sweep those two rails? Sweep two rails, yeah. So essentially, that's what we're going to do. So we're going to go to surface, sweep two rails. So first, select first rail, this top one here. Select second rail, this bottom one there. And then cross-section curves. Make sure to choose these in order, like so. So that looks good. Hit enter. And preview, you just want to make sure that the ISO curves look good. If you're on shaded, you can get a better preview. So that looks nice. Like, that looks like a good, solid, you know, smooth surface right there. So that's okay. So we can leave it do not simplify. So there, that looks great. Now, if you really wanted to be a stickler, you can see that right here, there is actually some sort of little indent that came from us making that bump. If you really don't want that, you can go and redraw this curve here. So this probably ballooned out a little bit too much. For our sake, though, it doesn't really matter. But if you want to fix that, that's something you can look for. There's always a, also, if you go under Analysis Tools, Surface, and then I believe it's Zebra. This is a weird command, but it actually, so the reason why this makes sense, so this is actually a very serious tool. That, let's say you were a car designer And you want to make sure that you add smooth curvature and that the curves broke at certain points for aerodynamic or aesthetic reasons. Essentially, you'd be looking for things like this where if it wasn't expected, so you see how it's going like that, following that curve, it's nice, and then all of a sudden the curvature changes. If that wasn't something that you wanted, then you know this would be a bad transition. For this though, it doesn't really matter. This actually might be kind of cool to render with, so maybe keep that in mind. But anyways, so that's that. I am going to mirror this, so I'm gonna go to transform mirror. And you can see view rendered. That looks pretty good. Now, this is kind of the new command I'll show you guys. I'm just gonna hide these two things for a second. So another command that's super useful is called curve network. So if you go to, surface from curve network. So if you go to surface curve network, it's going to say select curves in network. So probably what you want to do is leave on default so it auto sorts, so you don't have to deal with all this. So select curves in network, just select the curves that make sense to you, like so. Oh wait, those don't make sense. We want to split this one as well, sorry. So we just want the curves that are used in the top. So we want to make sure that these are all split properly. Okay, so this one we need to split it. So this. So we're just making sure that all the curves are kind of on the top like that. And then this one here we can also join. You want to make sure the curves stretch across like this. So that looks about right. So we can go to surface, curve network, choose our curves, hit enter. So select first curve in first direction, next open curve. Why did it not do auto? Auto sort. So enter. So last night it wasn't doing this. Apparently my curves were better. I'm just going to refer back to my model and see what is best practice for this. Okay. So apparently for the surface, this is something too where you're just going to want to, you know, I guess essentially, do I have one more curve? No. So essentially, if this command is giving you guff in one direction, you can always switch the direction. So what I mean by that is right now I was trying to make a surface going from here, 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 and then across there. But it might actually work better in this direction. But let's try running it through and see if we can make it here or work here. So we'll go surface, curve network, select curves in network. So I'm selecting the curves. Enter. Select first curve in first direction. Next open curve. So we want to select all the curves in one direction. In this case, it's a little bit different because they close on the end. Okay, so enter, select first curve in second direction, press enter to create surface. Unable to use this curve network, that's okay, because we're gonna try it the other way. So what I'm doing is I'm just splitting these and then joining them. So that we have, so the reason why I don't think that one worked is because we had one, two, three, four, five curves in one direction and then one in the other direction. But if we switch the direction of these outside curves by splitting them and then joining them, now we have 1, 2, 3 in this direction and 1, 2, 3 in the other direction. So I think that's why it didn't work that way. So let's try that again. Surface, curve network. I'm gonna select my curves. Hit enter. Ah, perfect. It looks like it's gonna work. So you wanna see something like that. And there is our nice surface. So I guess I'm gonna unhide the other guys here. So I guess the point of that is if it's not working, swap the directions of the curves. Does that make sense to you guys? Do you want me to go over it or explain it? Okay, well, with that then, let's take a 10-minute break, and then we'll jump back into this and applying a pattern. And oh, I should resume this. First of all, I just make sure that I have project and planar snap on quite a bit. And also, it's also really good to center your work on the origin. So that's why earlier on, I moved everything to the origin, because the origin point, so in this case, the z-axis, it just makes for a really convenient mirror origin. So you know that everything is just mirrored on this one point, no matter what direction it is, if your object is symmetrical. So I think in next class, after we sort of look at project one, I can show you guys some kind of tools for checking your geometry and making sure it's clean and how you'd go about fixing things if you've gone through all this and you're still having issues. But for now, what we're gonna do is we're just gonna continue on. So I'm gonna make a new layer for our surfaces we just made. So I'll call them base surfaces because we will change them. And then I'm gonna unhide the surfaces I just made. And I am going to change them to my base surfaces. So we can turn off our section curves. So now we just have this. Now, looking at the pattern on the bird's nest, we're gonna sort of do like a much simplified version of this. If you were doing this for your own project, you'd probably want to take a little bit more time in making this pattern. But in this case, we're just gonna, you know, do something that will take a lot less time. So essentially what we want to do is we want to draw that pattern in two dimensions. So the way we're gonna do that is we're gonna first find out like the approximate length and height of this surface. So to do that, we can go to Analyze, Curve. Actually, no, we won't. We'll go to, where is that? Again, one of these things I always type in. Analyze. Oh, sorry, Analyze Length. So under Analyze Length, so it'll say select curves to measure. I'm gonna select this length, so our bottom portion of this surface here. I'm gonna hit Enter. So you can see it's 199.26 mil. So in this case, what I'm gonna do is I'm just gonna draw a line here that's, let's say, let's just make it 200, like so. And then we're gonna analyze the height. So probably the height we want to use to make sure that we go for the tallest height here. I'm gonna turn back on my section curves layer. So we can, actually, that's still off. So I'll show you guys another command we can use. So essentially what we want to do is we want to find out the curve length of this ISO curve right here. The length tool, analyze length, if we look at it, won't work on this ISO curve. So how can we measure it? Essentially what we can do is we can go to our curve tools here, go curve, curve from objects, extract ISO curve, and then select surface for ISO curve extraction. We select our surface there, and you can see now we have this line going across like that. If we want in the other direction, we can go to direction V, since we're on U, and that just flips it. So now we go to our quad here, our mid, and then enter when done. So we have a curve there, and we want to do the same thing for this surface here. enter when done. And then the same thing for this section, this surface up here, enter. So now we have these three curves. I'm gonna join them, so they're one curve. So again, to do that, just to review, curve, curve from objects, extract ISO curve. And now what we can do is we can now use our analyze length, select curves to measure. We can choose our open curve there, hit enter to measure it. So 31.793 millimeters, we'll just go to 32. So in our top view here then, we can just draw 32, like so. So what I'm gonna do is I'm just gonna make a surface out of these curves. So why don't we go to surface, rectangular plane, corner to corner. We'll start right here. We'll drag up to here. And now we have a surface. So I'm just going to delete those curves. And also, I will delete that one reference curve we have. Oh, I already deleted it. That's good. So, and you'll see why we want to do this. But essentially, we want to more or less get the same dimension here as we have here in order to properly map the pattern. To make this pattern, since it's like these intersecting lines like this, I'm actually going to use Make2D in kind of a way that maybe it wasn't intended, but it works. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to draw a line like so. And then I'm going to use the pipe tool. So I'm going to go to solid pipe. And if you haven't used this, this just allows us to make what it says it does, just like a pipe, so a cylinder. So I'm just going to eyeball the radius. That looks good. Oh, that's tiny. Never mind. So maybe look at the whole curve. So I'm gonna go like that for the radius. If you want to keep the same radius, just hit enter, and then enter. And now you can see we have this pipe here. And then the way that I'm gonna sort of make these cross is I'm just gonna use some arrays. So I'm gonna go transform array linear. Oh, I went polar. Sorry, transform array linear. Number of items, let's go 14. Just going to go like that to start. And then I'm just going to start rotating some of them to just, you know, mess it up, I guess. Again, if you were doing this for your project, it actually would probably be good to see if you could find a elevation and, you know, trace that. Or else taking, like, let's say, an unfolded section or whatever you can find to make these a little bit more accurate. As it stands, I think all the lines in the bird's nest are more or less put there for exacting structural reasons. Obviously, this does not meet those same standards, but aesthetically, it kind of works. So, sure. That looks pretty good. Maybe I'll just make one more like this. And essentially what we want to do is we want to just make sure it more or less fits on top of our surface here. Like so. And like so. Okay, beautiful. Now what I'm going to do is I am going to use Make2D on this. So I'm going to select all of this. I'm going to go to the top view. And I'm going to go to Dimension, Make2D. And then current view, visible lines, we can put them on default. It doesn't really matter. Hit OK. Might take a second. But now we have our cool pattern. So I'm going to delete this because it's kind of in the way. So, but that's good. I'm going to hit join just in case any of these are open. That's good. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to take this surface. I'm going to duplicate it. And I'm going to move this pattern on top of the surface, like so. And then what I'm going to do is I'm actually going to take this pattern and I'm going to use it to split this surface. So I'm going to select my surface. I'm going to go to split, select cutting objects, all these curves. I'm going to hit enter. And now you can see one surface split into 130 pieces. I'm going to deselect the outer curves. So we just have the inner pieces left. I'm going to delete them. Drag back out this surface. We can delete all of these curves there. Now you can see we have this cool kind of nesting kind of pattern. Of course, you know, it's kind of a far cry from this, but again, for your own project, you'd probably go through and actually try to draw that out. So we're going to take this and we're actually going to align it with this surface. And the reason why we're going to do this is the next command we're going to use, which is a wonderful command, it needs a reference surface. So what we're going to do is we're going to select the pattern we want to flow along a surface. So like so. We're going to go to transform, flow along surface, and then copy yes, rigid no. So base surface, select near corner. So we're going to select our reference surface right there. Target surface, select near matching corner. We're going to select this corner here. So that's the end surface, or the end corner. It's the bottom right-hand corner. I'll click that. And then, whoa, it looks like our pattern stretched out the wrong way. Here, actually, let's look at this because this looks kind of neat. That actually looks pretty cool. But in our case, we're not going to go for this. So the reason, if that happens, that's okay. So in surfaces, essentially surfaces, if you look at your world coordinates, so you can see here we have our y-axis and our x-axis. Essentially, surfaces have their own internal coordinate system. So instead of x and y, it's called u and v. So in this case, you can see in the ISO curves here, essentially this is going to be the v coordinates, and this is going to be the u coordinates. So these coordinate systems stretch around the surface. They're not linear like the world coordinate system. So what was probably happening there is that this surface here, its u is in this direction, whereas this surface's u is in this direction. So when you flow along the surface, essentially what it does is Rhino thinks you're trying to match. I always forget that my fingers don't appear on the projector. It's trying to match from this way across the u direction this way. So to fix that, though, you can go to Surface Tools, Rebuild Surface UV. And then you can click on the direction, V, and that'll flip the direction. Hit Enter. So that's the little guy hammering on the square with arrows. And now let's try rerunning this command. Oh, no. So there's two surfaces here. Why don't we undo that, because I'm not sure which is which. So surface here, rebuild UV. Delete input, we want to put yes. So direction U, I think that's flipped. Let's hit enter. Oh, actually, is that the right command we want to do? We want to swap UV, unknown command. Well, anyways, let's see if this works. That may or may not be the right command. But if not, there's another way to do it. So let's try this again. So transform, flow long surface, copy, yes. So we select that. We select that, and it still works, or it still doesn't work, so that's okay. So the really kind of quick and easy way to do this is to just rotate the surface. So in other words, you can just go like that, and then you're going to want to scale it. So let's scale it so it matches this surface. So transform scale, scale 1D. So we'll scale this. Now let's try it. So surface, transform, flow along surface, select our corner, and click there, and now we have the right thing. So one thing to, I guess, take away from that is that I've been using Rhino for, God, like 9 years now, and I know probably 10% of the commands. There's going to be times where, like right there, I was like, swap UV, because that makes sense, and it should be something that Rhino has. It, and it does have, but I forget exactly what the command's called. That's where you would just open your help file and go to help topics, hit F1, swap UV, and then just scroll through here, or else just Google it, because McNeil has a great forum. So, but anyways, that looks good there. Let's make this into a new surface. So you can see I'm working with lots of different layers, so I'll just call this like texture surface. Let's make this red. Change object layer. I'm going to turn that off. So that looks pretty neat. And then I'm just going to mirror this. Again, we're mirroring along the origin, so I can just type in 0. And then we have here this pretty neat pattern. What we can also do now is we can join this. So I selected both surfaces, hit join, and now it's in one open poly surface. So that's kind of a neat way to pattern. Does anyone have any questions about that? Do you guys know the movie Ferris Bueller's Day Off? Bueller? Yeah, Bueller. When Ben Stein is repeating Bueller. Sometimes I feel like that. So, but enough self-pitying, we'll move on. So what we want to do, again, since this is an approximation, you could really, really spend a lot of time to draw out this pattern here. For the sake of this tutorial, what I'm going to do, actually, is just make sure that the pattern continues over into the curve. So the way I'm going to do that, if we look at our base surfaces here, we more or less know that this pattern's going to continue over the top and all around. So I'm just going to actually split this upper surface. So I'll use this guidelines layer because we don't really need it. I'll delete this one. And essentially what I'm going to do is I'm just going to start drawing lines across like this. And we are going to, so I'm going to turn off all the other snaps but end. So in this case, I'm just going to draw stuff all across. It actually doesn't even really matter if it's in the right plane or anything. What we are doing here, if you're splitting something, is we're just going to extrude surfaces anyways. Okay. That's going to be kind of a weird wide one, but you know what we're doing. We will take more time in your own project, please. This is actually like one of those times where, like a cooking show, I wish I just had the finished product. Make sure they don't overlap. Have you guys heard about those new glass coffins? No, me neither. It remains to be seen. Here's one. Why was the robot sad? It was programmed to be sad. Okay, someone has to help me out. One more joke, and then we'll stop this. But does anyone have a good one? Good? The bar's been set high, I know. Okay, so this is the last one I'm going to do because I don't know any more dad jokes. Okay, so more or less what you would do is you'd go through and you would, connect all these in a convincing way. So what we can do now is we have to make the center for this. So let's go back to our... Oh, that gap there looks pretty bad, but that's okay. So we're going to turn back on our reference to sort of get this oval right here. What we're going to do is we're going to go to our ellipse tool from center. Since we know everything's centered on zero, we're going to go to zero. So I'm just going to ellipse center there. I'm just going to enter zero. And then first axis right here, first axis right there. So that looks pretty good. Oh, except if you have on project and planar, it'll actually do what you want. So zero, go to this axis right here, and up like that. So that's perfect. And then now we can turn off our reference. We can select all these curves. So guidelines, select objects, and we can go transform, project to C-plane. And again, what that does is it just flattens them out onto our C-plane there, so our XY axis. The other thing now we want to do is we want to make sure that these curves will actually split our top surface. So it should, in theory, if we look at our base surfaces, they should, in theory, always split this top surface. Actually, they always will, but just double check. If you add some that you weren't sure about, like let's say the curve ended right there, right on the edge of what you want to split, you might want to extend it out. So now what we're going to do though is, first of all, we're just going to trim away all the curves that end up in this ellipse, because we know that's the opening for the stadium. So I just use trim there. I'm trimming away all of this just to clean it up. Like so. And then the other thing we want to do is just so we can use curve boolean to get rid of a lot of these internal intersecting curves, is we just want to go and draw ends to all these curves. So like this. If any of you are taking the Grasshopper modules, we'll be learning techniques to make kind of time-intensive tasks like this with complex geometry much more manageable. But for Rhino, you need to just go through. Perfect. And now I'm just going to offset this curve as well. So I'm going to type in offset the distance. Let's go 0.5. Whoa, way too small. Let's go 2 to make a ring there. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to select all these and go to curve boolean. So in your curve tools, it's a little square and circle overlapping. Delete input, we're going to set to all because we don't want any of these curves anymore. Combine regions, make sure it's on yes. I'm going to click outside of here. And then anywhere that we want to keep, so in this case, there's a little opening there. It looks like those are all intersecting. There's going to be a little opening here, one here. We're just going to click away where we want the openings there, there, and there. So that looks good. Hit enter. So there is the top of our bird's nest. I'm going to actually group this. So I'm just going to hit Control G to group it, just so it's easy to work with afterwards. So what I want to do now is turn back on my base surface layer, and I'm going to extrude these curves upwards so we can split the top. So maybe what we want to do, if we want to maintain this original layer just so we can go back to it or work with it, is we can always select this, and instead of, oh boy, we have a gap right here, huh? Okay, that's fine. So essentially what we're gonna do, our surface project, and I think it's just the way we built this surface, you can see it just projected there. But that's fine, because essentially what we can do is we can try exploding this surface, and you can see, yeah, it exploded into three surfaces. So we have these pieces here as well. So you can explode these into three surfaces as well, like that. And then we're gonna attach them to the top. So now we have this outer ring and this here. And you know, that might happen. When I was making this last night, it didn't, because I was making the curves in a different way, but this is nothing to worry about. When you're working with complex surfaces, they're gonna be in a bunch of different surfaces. So we're gonna copy both of these to our texture surface layer. So copy objects to layer, just so we have them. And then with this, I'm just gonna extrude up. So I'm gonna go surface, extrude curve straight. So you can see we get this pattern here. We don't need both sides on. Just make sure it's higher than your surfaces, like that. And then we're gonna split. So first we'll split this one here. So this guy will split with all of these. So I'm just gonna make sure I select all those. So now it's split into 23 pieces. And you can see here, remember how I was saying like you want to extend the curves just to make sure they actually cut all the way through? This is what I'm talking about. You can see they don't actually split all the way through because of these bulges. So to remedy that, what we're gonna do is we're gonna turn off this layer. So this is fine, it's just a little bit of housekeeping. Essentially what we're gonna do is we're just gonna explode these. We're gonna extend our curve, so you can go to curve, extend curve by line. I'm just gonna extend out all of these. Again, automation via Grasshopper makes stuff pretty nice and easy. So we're just gonna extend out all of these like so. And we just want to make sure to extend them out so they do indeed fully split that side surface we have. So let's keep going. And then we do the same thing. We're just going to draw at the end. So do that super quickly. Do you guys have any general questions about the chorus or Rhino while I'm just going through the other steps? Okay. Has everyone chosen their projects for the second one? Is anyone having a hard time finding a partner? Okay, good. Okay, so we're going to do the same thing, curve Boolean, delete all, yes, and then this one's easier. We just choose the things we don't want, like that, enter. Okay, so we're back on track. I'm going to hit Control G to group it, and now these will for sure split that side surface. So again, we're going to select this one here, or we're going to split it first. So we're going to go to Surface, Extrude Curve Straight, like that. We're going to select this one, go to Split, make sure we select all of these splitting curves, hit Enter. Now you can see, I'm just going to hide all these. We'll use them again. Maybe I'll group these as well to make it a little bit easier.
Why are you splitting and not doing a Boolean difference?
Good question. So the reason why I'm splitting and not doing a Boolean difference is that as it stands, these are all surfaces. So with surfaces, you're going to work more with splits. With solids, you're going to work more with Boolean differences. So we're just going to go through, again, in yours, you'll probably have more connections. We went through super quickly and just did like random small connections. So there's going to be a lot of gaps here, but that's okay. But you can see that where we did actually make the connections. So in this case, right there. Yeah, we made it right there. Right there. That's to be deleted. So we didn't make it there. There. Yeah, and we did. So you can see where we did make the connections, though. Like right there, we get those nice, smooth transitions. So that's what we're looking for. Of course, we have a lot of gaps here that you would fill in this top pattern. But as much as you guys loved my jokes, I didn't want to tell like 20 more while I finished that. So we're going to do the same thing. We're just going to split this top surface. So split. And then we can just delete this because we don't need it anymore. And then we can just delete away the stuff we don't need. So now we have kind of an approximation of the outer structure, the bird's nest. Like that. So that looks pretty good. Of course, it has a bunch of gaps. You'd do more. But for the most part, if you were to show this to someone, they'd know which building you were trying to, you know, model. So what I'm going to do actually is I'm going to try to join some of these. We might not be able, actually I can just select all these. So Rhino won't let you join certain surfaces if the UVs are totally different. But I'm going to select all of these and hit join and see what happens. So actually this did work. It did join into one open poly surface. So that's great. If yours doesn't totally join together for some reason, don't worry about it. It's no big deal. But it is nice in our case that this worked out. I'm actually going to delete those bottom curves because we don't need them either. So one really nice command when you have this surface is offset. So this is something that's super useful if you're working with kind of more complex curves. So we're going to go to surface, offset surface, and you're going to see it's going to have all these arrows come out, and that's going to show you the offset direction. Now, we might have to do some housekeeping here because you can see that at the top, our surfaces are going outwards, and on the bottom, they're going inwards. And that's obviously not going to give us what we want. So in order to fix that, what we want to do is we actually just want to explode this. We want to take these two bottom surfaces. We can go to Surface Tools. And then there's this tool here, Flip Direction. I think you can just also type in Flip Direction or something. I always just go here under the Surface Tools, so it can also be under Standard, your Surface Tools, and then the arrows on top of the surface here. You can see that right-click. So again, when you see that little mouse icon there, it tells you which mouse button does which command. So we want to go Flip Direction, so I'm going to right-click it. So you can see here, flip the direction of two objects. We're going to join these again. One open poly surface. And now when we go into surface, offset surface, you can see that all the arrows are the right way. And this is what we want, to just have a consistent, kind of intuitively correct direction for everything. Now there's a few things you can do. We are going to go to solid yes, because we want to make this a solid geometry. If the arrows are going in the wrong way, I usually find that you get better results by by offsetting outwards rather than inwards. Because if you flip inwards, let's say my knuckles are points on a surface. If you're going to flip outwards, it's going to be able to expand. But if you're flipping inwards, you can't push those in anymore. So if you have like a corner like this, it's going to crush into itself. So flipping outwards usually gives you better results, or offsetting outwards. And then the distance, I think this offset here was 2. So we don't want this too thick. Also, the thicker the offset, the more likely it is to mess up. So in this case, I'm just going to go 1, because that actually probably looks about right for our scale. So distance, don't worry about the corners. You can play around with them. Sharp is good for what we want. Round will, of course, round out the offset, but you can see here it looks like the corners are actually pretty sharp. Solid, tolerance, don't worry about. Delete input, yes. Flip all, so hit enter. And this might take a while, but it will bring your geometry into 3 dimensions. You couldn't 3D print what we have as it stands on the screen right there, because these surfaces are infinitely thin. But you couldn't 3D print this because it failed to make a solid, which is fine. So you can see if we go to our properties, open poly surface, you can see that in some places, because of geometry like this, it wasn't able to create a closed surface. If you really want to make a closed surface out of this, essentially you can go through and cap these holes, or else, if you're having difficulty, what you can always do is you can actually offset it in chunks. So let's try the bottom chunk here. Go again, surface, offset surface, solid, yes. So you're looking for a solid. So again, offset surface failed to create a solid. There can be a few reasons this happens. Probably it's just because of all these angles. I'll show you a tool. If you want to figure out where it failed to make the close solid, you can go to select your object, go to analyze, and then edge tools, and then show edges. And now it's going to show your naked edges. So naked edges, zoom. And you can see that where it failed to close was actually along these bends here. So what this suggests to me, if you're looking at this, if it's just really having a problem with these connections here, what I'd do is I'd actually break this up further. So in other words, I would just offset the bottom so we can connect these. So solid, or surface, offset surface, solid, yes, distance one. We can even try decreasing the distance to help it out, 0.6. So now you can see this is a closed poly surface, so closed poly surface. And then what we'd do is we'd just do the same thing for all of these. So we can go to the side ones, join them, and then surface, offset surface, make sure they're all in the right direction. Solid, yes, distance 0.6, enter. So these are all open, but whatever, we can fix that. And then this one will do the same thing, offset, solid, yes. And now we have that. If you get little edges like this, you see where they're disjointed, that's where it's probably best to join these if you want to avoid that. So we're going to join those, surface, offset surface, solid, yes. So essentially with all of this, if you wanted to use this model for a render, like this would be A-okay. Even if there's some naked edges in here, you can always fix them afterwards. But for a render, view rendered, like this works fine. Like you can make drawings off of this. Essentially, it does have these open edges here. But if you wanted to fix them, you could go in and sweep two rails along those edges, for instance. If you did want to 3D print this, you'd have to go through and sort of join everything and make sure it's solid. But for the most part, that's how one would create the outside structure of kind of complex geometry like this. So that's more or less what we wanted to talk about today, is how to make complex shapes. So does anyone have any questions with this? No, more or less makes sense. And like I said, so next class, first half of the class, we're going to be presenting our first project. So please make sure in the assignment folder here, so hand in folder, assignment one, have your assignment in class. I'm going to say before this class starts at 10, before 9:30, because Kara and I are going to copy them from Dropbox onto a computer and just project them on the screen. So you don't have to print them out, but you need to have it in there by 9:30. And after that, once we go through that, we can just have a class where we're sort of, Kara and I are walking through, helping you with your projects. And if you have any questions about, like, for example, how you'd fix this, then we will cover that. And also this weekend on Sunday, what I'm going to do again is I'm going to have a tutorial on topography and making super, super accurate topography from either like LiDAR data or GPS data. So if you guys want to do that, I'll be in here at noon. And I can also help you with your projects, of course. So that's it. Thanks.